Okay. I know it looks like night out here, but it's actually day. It's super bright out here. I basically just edited all the people out behind me, as well as muted them. And so today I'm talking about understanding fragrances and a little bit about perfumery, because I started trying to make my own blends. Just understanding the components of what goes into a perfume or fragrance and how they're kind of structured. And it turns out there is kind of a, not a formula, but like a underlying template that is a good idea to follow. There's a lot of things going on in what's called niche perfumery, where just things evolve, just like music. The fragrances have evolved through time, and I've been fortunate enough to be able to sample some of these niche perfumeries and like designer perfumes. I have a set of notes of just basic concepts I want to go over, and what I've learned so far about fragrances and perfumery. Most people don't realize how ubiquitous fragrances are in all sorts of products: hair products, toothpaste, lotions, soaps, things you might put in your car, things you spray in your home, candles. It's just everywhere. And it's usually in these products, it's present in only a really small concentration, and it lasts just for a short amount of time. But it's something that's just under the surface that most people don't realize is there. Just straight up like perfume and cologne in a store, you probably have heard these terms like eau de toilette, eau de cologne. And that actually refers to the concentration. So I'll put a diagram up, but there's basically different levels where there's like the strongest is parfum extrait, and it basically refers to the percentage by mass, I think, of how much of the raw aroma chemical ingredients are in the mix and how much is like alcohol and other unscented ingredients. I was actually never a person to go and wear a lot of fragrances. I just in the past couple months got interested in this. There's so many smells out there to explore, and the majority of them, what goes into perfumes and colognes is nowadays it's not natural ingredients. It's actually going to be mostly synthetic aroma chemicals, sometimes natural. The reason is that natural chemicals are just more, are naturally like things extracted from flowers and resins, herbs. They'll do like a steam distillation, and these materials just end up being more expensive, so they're not, it's just hard to bring those to scale. Whereas the synthetic aroma chemicals, which make up the majority of most perfumes, will be, you know, easier to, be a lot cheaper to manufacture. And what I think is cool is that there's the majority of these chemicals are not things that you would come across in nature. So it's really, there's a huge amount of potential there to go and smell these smells that you would just never encounter in nature, and that we're not, our olfactory system's not evolved to even be able to perceive. I had been doing like spirit tasting. I had been trying to get a sense of what rye whiskey was, and like what and getting exposed to like baijiu's, the Chinese spirit. What I realized was that in fragrances, you don't have the constraint as much. You don't because it's not edible, because it doesn't have to be edible. You lose that constraint. My sort of conjecture is that there's literally a wider range of smells that exist in the world of fragrances because they're not constrained to be edible. And most things are not, most things can be a little bit toxic that they use if you were to consume them. And there's all these kind of like, there's an organization called IFRA. A lot of the perfumers talk about this, where you can't have above, you know, a certain concentration of chemical X due to the IFRA regulations. And the reason of that is because it may cause some irritation on the skin. One example is like oak moss was like a naturally derived, like actually based on lichen, an essential oil. They do steam distillation, extract out the essential oils, or they make an absolute, it's called, and that apparently for some people caused some allergic reactions. So they really, over time, it just basically faded out, where before it was like a really popular ingredient in many fragrances. Yeah, I'm going off topic, but the point is just there's such a huge range. There's just so many aspects, the way in which these fragrances can vary. There's so many different properties that puts them in a very, very high dimensional space of fragrances. And you know, one example is like the masculine feminine axis. Nowadays, there's an increasing amount of like unisex fragrances. To me, it actually is the most important and the widest category, because it doesn't have the constraint of smelling kind of more light and floral and feminine, and it doesn't have the, on the opposite side, the constraint of smelling more masculine. And there's just certain, culturally, there's certain smells that are associated with either side. And it's just a lot of the niche houses, perfume fragrance houses, are experimenting a lot more with like unisex fragrances. Whereas in the past, you could imagine it was, there felt like there needed to be a gender divide in the world of fragrances. When, I mean, you think about it, there actually isn't one that exists. It's just we have, you know, the boundaries is hazy. Another axis of variation in this huge manifold of fragrances is past, present. And I'm going to show one example that is kind of from as far, I think, back in the 40s. And you can tell that some of these are just so dated. Like there's certain, when you go and smell these older fragrances, you can tell that it's like from a different time. It's really from a different era. There's no one here. I thought I heard something. Okay, where are we? Let's talk about, those are just two examples, the past, present, and the masculine, feminine axis. So there's certain vocabulary that you need to know when discussing what I call the dynamics of fragrances. And this is not something I made up. I really got inspired by looking at this website called Base Notes, where these people review fragrances primarily, and there's also like little forums and stuff dedicated to people making their own perfumes and buying perfumes, and like people are searching the market and all sorts of things. But what struck me is how poetic some of these people were when describing these fragrances. It was just the imagery, the visual that they create, that they're able to like portray in describing how transporting these fragrances are, how much it kind of like evokes certain like visceral feelings. But you come across these terms again and again, and I could see this when I started looking at these reviews, that there's certain vocabulary that I want to go over some of these terms, because it's really important. One of the most important concepts that I think most people don't understand, and that I learned in this process, is basically that fragrances are dynamic in time. When you first put it on, or you first open the bottle or smell it, it's going to smell a certain way. And then as it goes through what's called the dry down is like the period of the hours after. You can imagine it kind of, it's changing during that period of time. The reason why it changes is, firstly, that the aroma chemicals, some of them, I feel like by oxidation things, they literally do change in the way that they smell over time. But the more important factor that's talked about is that you have what's called top notes, middle notes or heart notes, and base notes. And base notes, that's the name of the website named after this idea. And what that basically refers to is there's these roughly these three levels of volatility, or they try to group them into those three levels of how volatile that smell is. And so the top notes are things which come at you first, they kind of come off the top. They are the first to leave. And some of them leave within like 2 minutes. It's like very, very quick how, lavender is a good example. These notes, which are the top notes, will form they're oftentimes like thought of as what helps sell that fragrance, because they're what people smell when they first smell it. And they only smell it for like a brief period. They're like, no, not that one. No, not this one. So what they're smelling mostly is those top notes. So you have the construction of a fragrance is built around these three categories, in a sense, where you have to have these top notes, which kind of give an initial impression. And these could be like citrusy things, or just there's just certain ones. They have a lower molecular weight. They just leave quicker. The middle notes are just things which stick around a little bit longer. And then the base notes are the things that are like the foundation that stick around for the hours. And those are really important, because that's what's going to be with you long after the middle and top and heart notes have gone away. And so like musk, which is like a huge component of many colognes and fragrances, is one of these base notes. Something like a natural base note would be something like patchouli. That shows up a lot. Honestly, most things you wouldn't recognize, because as I've been working with these aroma chemicals, most people would not, unless you're a perfumer, you would not recognize the names of these. It's just a bunch of chemical names. Exaltide, galaxide, embretolide, ambroxan. They talk about the performance of a fragrance, and that basically means, as to my knowledge, it means two things mainly: the longevity, how long it kind of will stick around. And that's another thing, it's important to have those base notes, because if you don't have some base notes component, your longevity will be very short. And then performance can also refer to the projection, which means basically the amount of sillage. And sillage is like the word for the vapor trail that if you're walking past someone, it's generally a good thing to have it's like the fragrance is like more potent, or it may allow, you know, you don't want to be putting so much that you're filling up a room with this stuff, but it's the trail. How much does it kind of leave an aroma trail? Another important concept is that of accords. Accord is talked about a lot. It's basically you're playing a chord like on a guitar or a piano. It's a concept in perfumery that most people are not aware of, that you combining several different singular notes and you're creating sort of a different smell out of that. It kind of has a way of transforming into something else. And it's a very useful thing for perfumers, because oftentimes you want to create a smell out of your aroma chemicals to make it smell like something for which there isn't really a naturally derived scent for. I think like apple is one example. One common one that comes up a lot nowadays is oud. Oud or agarwood is like a prized incense. It's like a wood which becomes infected with microorganisms and fungus. And it starts releasing this kind of resin, and then wood that's kind of saturated with this resin gets used as an incense in some countries in the Middle East. And it's a beautiful smell, but it's extremely rare nowadays. It's like very scarce. And so again, the perfumeries don't have, unless it's like a really niche perfumer, like someone like Arij Ladore, who's like trying to, who is willing to make that expense. Normally you can't bring that to scale. So they have to create a oud accord out of these different chemicals to try to put them together to make something which smells kind of like oud. And there's so many houses now that have an oud fragrance, and most of them, I got to go into a perfume store and smell some of these, and it's all just based around oud accords. They're not really using actual oud essential oil. So accords are really important, and they kind of, I think even the way that perfumes are constructed is based around creating accords first. So you have like these groups of aroma chemicals, and then you then take those. Each accord could be basically anything more than one single aroma chemical, like 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 notes could be, or aroma chemicals could be in one accord. And then I think the way it's done professionally is that they then go and combine these accords in certain amounts. And that is, so you may end up with like 50 different or 100 different aroma chemicals in a single fragrance. And you're not really meant to, it's not like you're meant to be able to pick out every single one of those. You're just, they're contributing, they're adding a little something to one of the accords in there. So you can see how fragrances, like, you don't, we don't realize, but they have this kind of modular structure, almost like hierarchical kind of structure. It's interesting when you mix them together, some of them are, they vary in three factors that I've identified. Well, four, I guess. Obviously, they vary in how they smell, their scent. They vary in their potency or their concentration. And oftentimes you have to make dilutions because it's too potent. They vary in how they transform over the dry down, and they vary in their volatility. In my aroma chemical kit, it kind of lists, it categorizes them as this is a base note, a mid note, or a top note. And the idea is, like, when you're making a fragrance, you want to combine base, middle, and top notes to have a nice, smooth dry down. Another thing I've realized in working with these aroma chemicals is that some of them are so, I think they call it impact, or I had been calling it like the potency of it. Like, it's just so, it's basically, some of them are detectable at a very small concentration. So like citral, for example, or peppermint essential oil, you have to dilute that down in alcohol, and then you add only a couple drops of that diluted material, and you can still, it can still overpower the fragrance. Like the first one I made, I didn't realize that this chemical, styralyl acetate or something, it has a really strong rhubarb and kind of gym floor rubber kind of smell to it. And it's actually so, the impact of that is so high that I added a single drop out of this, about 30 drops of aroma chemicals. To that 30 drops, you would then add like alcohol to bring it to like 20% concentration. That one drop totally took over everything else I had going on. Some of these compounds are in there at like fractions of a percent, and then other ones will be there at like 30%. So it's all about like achieving that right balance. If you don't, that dilution of the really high impact chemicals is important, because it will just completely dominate the scent if you don't achieve the right balance. It's honestly really hard to find information out there about how to compose fragrances, because it's an industry which is, I think just historically and still currently, is built around secrecy. Because like, if you knew the recipe, you would in principle be able to just go and copy someone's perfume. Like, it doesn't take that much skill to actually make the product if you know how to make it. You just combine, like, if you're giving me the recipe, I can make the perfume in like 15 minutes. But what takes hours and hours is picking out, selecting what notes that you want to go in there, and titrating them in, kind of trying to achieve the right balance. And you have these kind of effects that you're trying to achieve, or you want maybe some citrus to kind of cut through the deep earthy tones of some other accord that's going on in there. Perfume bottles, you know, they cost like, the average size bottle is like $100 to $200. So you see some of these YouTubers that like have these massive wall-to-wall collections. I would last about one bottle before I ran out of funds to support that. So What I did instead was get like these little tiny sample vials, and that's so much better. It allows you to sample a large set, see what kind of what's out there in the market. And it's just, there's just so many interesting things. This is not as important unless, it's just something to be aware of, is olfactory fatigue. You just, after anything, any sense, even visual or just hearing the word, hearing the same word multiple times, you start to not know what that word means anymore. Try it. And then olfactory fatigue, if you keep smelling, like when I'm working on these things, you desensitize basically. And it can really obscure, it's like you're kind of like trying to move forward in some direction and you can't really see where you're going, because you just start to not be able to smell these chemicals very well. And it actually becomes a danger if you put some on and then it's really strong and you can't smell it, and you keep putting more and more on, and then you don't realize that other people, you know, you become desensitized to that, and you don't realize that to other people you smell really intensely. That's like, it's my worst nightmare. So that's just something to be aware of, that you have to be able to know or try to predict when you might be fatigued, so that you should probably just like back off. This is something that I came up with. That's an interesting idea. There's kind of scents, they're kind of go beyond just what it smells like. I'm not talking about, everybody talks about how like a smells are associated with memories really strongly, which is true. Something I haven't heard a lot of people talk about is there's a kind of what I would call a tactile component to smells. A great example is like menthol, or you smell something really minty like peppermint and it has that cooling sensation. That's one of the strongest examples of what I'm talking about, where like it goes beyond just that's what it smells like. It's actually creating some kind of sensation in addition to that smell in your head. Another example would be something like capsaicin. If you smell like a habanero or like a super hot chili, it may smell, there's like kind of a white hot stinging. To me, it smells good. I like hot stuff, but there's many examples of that where it kind of, if you pay attention, it kind of creates a sensation. So I have a couple fragrances that I've been able to sample, and they cover a wide range. The first one is called Demeter Dirt. This is a really great example of an Accord. Wow, it smells so good outside. this company, they tried to make these fragrances which smelled like natural materials, and just a whole bunch of different items that are not really common smells in perfumery, but this is probably their most famous one, called Dirt, and it really does smell like potting soil or like wet soil. And there's no compounds in here that were probably not, they were not derived from dirt, but it's amazing how it creates that smell of what most people would think of as like soil. And it's done using that, it's basically an Accord. Somehow they stumbled upon this mix of just the right chemicals and just the right balance to create this dirt smell. Is very interesting. I'll just show you what this thing looks like I'm holding. You can't see it, but okay, we'll do this one. I thought it was important to kind of learn about the history of some of these fragrances, and I have like this one called Danger by Parfum Ciro. This is kind of emblematic of this like classic French style. This is the one that I was talking about, that's like from the 40s. I think, I'll have to check it. It's old. You can just tell so easily that this is like, it's like powdery, that this is not something that you probably would come across nowadays. It's not really trendy. It's just, it frankly smells like an old lady. It's floral, floral, it's like probably one of the largest categories in perfumes besides musk. And so I can't identify what particular, I'm really bad at identifying what type of flower that would be. But it just has this real powdery kind of essence, and I don't have the good vocabulary to describe what this is, but it's just, it definitely smells kind of dated, and like, you really learn the most about these things when putting them side by side. That's when they kind of create a contrast for each other. And there's been so many incidents where I had smelled something later that made me understand something that I had already smelled better. This one was from an Arab house called Abdul Samad Al-Qurashi. Yes, from Saudi Arabia. And this, oh gosh, you, one of the most interesting things, one of the best things about this is when you really smell something that you have never smelled before and it's in a good way. I think part of why I do this is like, it's so interesting to go and try to discover these new smells that you've never seen before. It really is like, I describe it as like seeing like a new color. It is just totally crazy experience to come across a scent that you, it's almost at first as if your brain doesn't want to accept that it exists or can't imagine that this is real. When I first smelled this, I was like, this is like this woody kind of scent, but it has this medicinal and kind of piney notes that I wasn't familiar with. You kind of like take it out, and it's like this oil. I know you can't see that, but it's, you would kind of, oh my gosh, it's even changing outside. That is just incredible. This is one that does not have a lot of sillage. It's more of like a, what they would call a personal scent. It's like stays close to the body. It's a very fundamentally, I'd say, like, is a strong woody smell. It just has this freshness to it that is like, it just makes you feel like you're outdoors when you're indoors. It's just so incredible that how fresh that is. It's completely in a different part of the space from like Western perfumery. Like you just will not come across that type of profile in any Western perfume. It's just, it's very different and fascinating. This is something in a similar category. Baikal Gris. It apparently contains ambergris and some sandalwood, I think. Wow, these are smelling totally different outside. I don't know. That's a tip. You need to go outside to smell them better. Ambergris, I still don't know what exactly it smells like because it's like a rare, it's one of these naturally derived, more super rare actually materials. It's like an excretion from a sperm whale or some type of whale that drifts around on the ocean, and you basically have to find it on the beach. There's no way to, and it's like extremely valuable per kilogram because it's so hard to find, and it's valued in perfumery because it has some interesting characteristic smell and it's like a base note. I still don't know exactly how to identify it, but it's just, it's a kind of interesting spicy cinnamon kind of smell. And this is, this one smells very like of the earth, like very natural. This was something that I'm picking out these examples that were like actually really stood apart from the rest from this set of samples that I got. It's fascinating, called Nizé 10. This is like apparently from 1924 is created, and it is like, I described it as like walking into a smoky hotel lobby, or like people have described it as like the back of a New York taxi cab at the end of a long shift. It's like, it smells like smoky, like old, dirty. It smells super dirty. But in the most interesting way, it's like, it's almost like it's gotten so old that it now is novel again, because it's so different from anything that you would smell. It's that really like, it's like a, it's like kind of like overly masculine without being like musky. Maybe like an old dirty suitcase. I swear it smells like some secondhand smoke in a hotel. It's just, you have to, this one is just so interesting. It's gotten so, it's been around for so long, but it's just fascinating how different that is from colognes that we have nowadays. And the last one, yeah. This is one that I, the second one that I made, and I came across this really interesting accord that then was just as a dominant accord in this, based on like juniper essential oil and citral. And it is just such a great fresh smell. The two of those together just turned out to be such a great accord. It smells very piney. There's also in this, like there's some cedar wood as more of like a base, like Texas cedar wood. And there's like a juniper and citral that really, they come off in the top note. Something about that is just so, so good. Okay, so I hope that was informative if you're interested in learning about fragrances. I'm not an expert. I've just started learning about this stuff, but there's just such a huge amount of smells to explore out there. So just go out and try to pay attention to and kind of compare and analyze what you're smelling, and you'll find that there's just a huge range of stuff. They oftentimes, people describe them as like narcotic, like you're smelling those and it's just like, oh my god, it creates such a beautiful sensation in your head. It just smells, some of these things just smell so incredible. So with that, I'm going to sign off and hand it to Astrud Gilberto. Peace out. Eu sempre fui só de você.